And so whether you're here in this sanctuary, or you're watching online, live streaming, or Roku, or Facebook, or wherever that is, listen, we have all kinds of platforms to be a part of our church family. I want to make sure you know, whether you're here watching live streaming or listening to us, I want you to know that you are a part of our church family. That's really important for us, that you feel you're part of something that God is doing in a church setting, in a family setting. And that's good to know when our world is facing all these fears that we don't know what's going to happen this week, let alone next month. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And there's all this fear out there. You watch the news. Now, I watch way more news than I should have this week. Anybody with me? And there's all, but listen, I want to tell you something. You're never going to hear this out in the media, but I want to tell you right here in our church family, whether you're watching online or here in the sanctuary or in our third space, you're part of a church family, and together we're going to get through this. Amen? And I know what you're saying. You're saying, okay, Craig, how do you base your faith? What's the foundation of your faith in saying that? Well, the foundation of our faith is in a God that loves us, in a God that cares for us. He sent his son to die on the cross for our sins so that we could have a relationship with him. He died on the cross. 3 days later, he rose from the dead to prove he has power over death, power over sin, and he has the power to address the greatest fears that we could ever possibly have in our life. And that's the foundation of our faith. It is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that's why 5 weeks from today, I can't wait. 5 weeks from today, we are going to have not a regular celebration. We are going to have a huge celebration about what the difference the resurrection makes in each one of our lives. Anybody ready for it? Man, it feels like Easter already. I walked in today and I saw the cross over there. I can't hardly look at it without getting emotional. And I saw the cross, realize it's empty. Anybody see that it's empty? And I'm telling you, that is the coolest thing. But I got to calm down. I got to get into my sermon now. And I want to begin a new sermon series. Maybe you saw this. I'd like to talk to you, but before I get into the sermon series, I want to ask you to do something, and this is a pretty personal thing, and I want to make sure you know you're not going to have to tell the person beside you. That's really, some of you are going, I don't want to tell the person beside me. That's all right. You don't have to. This is between you and God, but I want to ask you to take a little bit of a spiritual inventory, and I want you to ask yourself deep in your heart, deep in your soul, where are you in your spiritual journey? I want to give you a couple options to help you. One option is that you've heard about Jesus. You kind of know about the Jesus thing, that he loves you, that he died on the cross for you. He rose from the dead. You've heard that, but you've got lots of questions. You've got lots of things, and you're here today not because you're ready to make a decision. You're here because you're kind of kicking the tires, and you're kind of checking it out, and you got lots of doubts. Let me give you another option. And that is the option where you are saying, no, Craig, I'm on a journey with Jesus Christ. And maybe you'd say today, Craig, I've accepted Jesus into my life. And you said, Jesus, who died on the cross for you, Jesus, who paid for your sins, I've opened my life to him, and I'm inviting him to forgive me of my sins. I want him to be my Lord, my Savior. I want him to be the ruler, the king of my life. And within that category of you who have said yes to Jesus Christ, is a wide, extreme, wide range of people. There's on one side, there's that group of people that would say, hey, I'm a Christian. I have a Bible. I don't know where it is. Anybody have that in that situation? No, don't raise your hand on that. Craig, I have an OVCN sticker on my car. That's worth something, right? But you would say, you know what, Craig, I go to church when I don't have anything else to do, and you're a Christian, but there's probably not a lot. You would have to admit today, if it's just between you and God and you're being honest, probably not a lot of spiritual formation going on in your life. The other extreme is that you sit here today and you're going, well, no, Craig, I'm like Jesus Jr. And then there's everybody else in between those two. And take a second just to identify where you are, because it will be helpful in our journey. Let me go back to that first option just real quick. Those people who are kind of kicking the tire, you got questions, you got doubts, you're not really sure, but you're here. And I just want you to know that as you're asking questions and you're not really sure, you haven't made a decision, I want you to know right from the start that you're in the right place. And everybody said amen. That's really important. I want you to know that OVCN is a safe place for you to come and investigate and get your questions answered. I'm thrilled that somebody cared enough to invite you to come and be with them today and worship with us today. And I hope you feel like you're part of the church family, that you might come and my goal for you, my prayer for you, is that you might come and you might understand to some degree just why it is that we're such big fans of Jesus Christ. And my prayer for you is that maybe during these next few weeks as we journey towards our journey towards Easter in this series, is that something might be said that it, all of a sudden it gets kind of personal and that you might find something amazing about Jesus. But I just want to let you know, whether you do or not, I am thrilled that you're here and thank you for joining us and being a part of our church family. As you take your notes out, I want you to see that the series is called When Life Encounters Jesus. And the specific title of today is The Path to Greatness. And we're going to talk about having an incredible encounter with Jesus. And we're going to look at this story where Jesus has this encounter with a rich guy and a guy that was trying to find out the way, the path to greatness. Greatness resonates with each one of us. Because greatness is something that is in this universal tug in our hearts that we want to be great. We want greatness to identify us. But there's something about greatness that we all kind of think. We think greatness is kind of exclusive. We think that greatness is not, greatness, Craig, is reserved for those people. Greatness is not for people like you and me. And we think that we can play the game of life, but really to be truly great, I don't think that's us. The disconnect is that when you were growing up, you truly wanted to be great. Can you remember when you were growing up as a kid, there was something in your heart that you said, you know what, I want to be great. Maybe somebody inspired you to be great. When I was a kid, there was the thing I wanted to be more than anything else, I wanted to be a great hockey player for the Toronto Maple Leafs. I have some Toronto Maple Leafs fans here. I'm telling you, I grew up in Canada in grade school, and I thought, man, this is the greatest thing in the world. I'm going to go and I'm going to play for the Toronto Maple Leafs. I want to be Davy Keon. Anybody? Okay, don't clap if you don't really mean this. Does anybody know who even Davy Keon is? Does anybody know? Yeah, I got a couple people. Yeah, there we go. And I would always practice when I was outdoors practicing in the ice, you know, or even in the church parking lot. I would go over to the Catholic church. They had a big parking lot, and we would practice on their parking lot, and we'd set up two rocks as goals on each end, and we would play street hockey. And I remember scoring. In my mind, I was like, I was scoring the final goal. As time was running out, I was scoring in the Stanley Cup playoffs. I was scoring the winning goal for my Toronto Maple Leafs. I remember one time I was playing in my basement, and not a great place to play hockey, I admit that. But I was playing, and I had my stick, and I had a tennis ball, and I was kind of hitting it off the cement wall. And as I'm flicking it back and forth, all of a sudden I scored a goal, and it was an incredible goal. I remember it was so good. It was so good that I did what every hockey player does when they score. I lifted my stick up in the air like this, and I went, yay! And all of a sudden it was raining down glass on me. I'd stuck my stick right through the light fixture and just broke it in a million pieces. My parents didn't think it was such a great idea, and for that reason, I wasn't able to play hockey for a little bit. So that's sad, isn't it? But I got to tell you the reason I was never really great at hockey. It took a lot of time. It took a lot of sacrifice to learn how to play like that and to be a great hockey player. But the reality is that my desire for greatness, I want to be honest with you, that has not disappeared in me. To this day, I still have that desire for greatness that is inside of me. In fact, just a couple weeks ago, I'm not sure if you saw this, but in the Toronto Maple Leafs had a Zamboni driver. You say, what's a Zamboni driver? It's the guy that gets on that machine and rides around the ice, and after every period cleans off the ice. Everybody know what a Zamboni driver is now? And the Zamboni driver for the Toronto Maple Leafs, there was an emergency. Both the goalies for the other team went out, and so they called the Zamboni driver, 42 years old, to come in. And he won the game for the other team that was playing the Toronto Maple Leafs. And I know that's sad, and I thought, but that's great on one side because I'm ready for the call. I said, hey, I called him up and I said, I'm ready. I'm down here in Arizona, but I can be there in just a day. But as I mature, I want you to know this. And I think this is true for you as well. I think it's for everybody, that my desire for greatness, to do something great, has decreased. But to be somebody great has increased. You say, what do you mean? I want to be a great husband to my wife. I want to be a great father for my kids that are older now. I want to be a great papa for my granddaughter. I want to be a great friend. I want to be a great lover of life. That when people look at my life and they say, here's how Craig lived his life. He loved life. I want to be a person that has great compassion for people that are hurting. I want to be a great Christian. I don't want mediocrity to define who I am. I don't want my kids to look back at my life and go, yeah, Dad was kind of average. I don't want my wife to look at me at the end of my life and go, yeah, he took up a lot of unnecessary space. I don't want my friends to look at me and go, well, you know, I wasn't really a friend to Craig. It was more like an acquaintance. And I don't want God to sigh and go, Craig who? Listen, the reason I continue to desire greatness is because God has wired that desire of greatness in me. And I believe that God has wired that same desire for greatness in you as well. Jesus did not live an amazing life. Jesus did not die on the cross. Jesus did not resurrect from the dead so that you and I would have a mediocrity type of life. We desire greatness. But if I'm honest with you, I'll tell you this, being great, in the arena of character qualities, of being a great father, a great husband, great friend, it's incredibly difficult, isn't it? There's a lot of times in my life where I just kind of look at the way I live and I think, well, I don't even meet up to my own expectations, let alone the expectations that other people have for me. And sometimes I feel like I just, you know what, maybe I don't have what it takes to be great. And there are times that I'm embarrassed to admit that, you know what, those areas where I really need to trust God, that it's really crucial that I just, okay, God, I trust you, I believe, sometimes I don't do that. And maybe in your desire for greatness, you want something deeper. You want something more meaningful to happen in your life. You don't want your friendships to be average. You don't want your marriage to be routine. You don't want your career to be unfulfilling. You don't want your bad habits to be the thing that defines who you are. You don't want to be consumed by conflict all the time. You don't want to live a forgettable life. Does that resonate with you? You want something more. There's got to be this path to greatness. And I got to tell you, the great news is today there is this path to greatness. And Jesus gives us the how-to that matches up with our want-to. So we're going to take a look at an encounter between Jesus and this man that was rich. It's in Mark chapter 10. And in Mark chapter 10, starting with verse 17, Jesus gives us, he says in this passage, here's the path to greatness. This story is also told, I need to tell you, in Matthew and the book of Luke. Three of the four Gospels, this story is told. But we're going to specifically look at Mark chapter 10, starting verse 17. These verses are all in your notes. All these verses are coming up on the screen, so you can follow in your Bibles or however else you want to. Verse 17 says this. Then Jesus was starting out on a trip, and a man came running up to Jesus. I love that. I'll come back to that. Running up to Jesus, knelt down and asked, good teacher, what should I do to get eternal life? Right away, I love this guy because he comes running up. He shows all this passion. He runs up to Jesus and he's out of breath, but he asks the most important question about eternal life. Verse 18. Jesus responds to that question and says, why do you call me good? Only God is truly good, but as for your question, you know the commandments. Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not testify falsely, do not cheat, honor your father and mother. Verse 20, teacher, the man replied, I've obeyed all these commands since I was a child. Every once in a while, my imagination runs wild, and I imagine, I actually, as I'm reading scripture, I put myself right there in the room as this thing is taking place. Anybody ever do stuff like this? And your imagination, in my imagination, I am the 13th apostle. And I'm not seeing anything, but I'm standing over in the corner listening to all this, and here's this guy, he comes running in, and out of breath, he asks a question. Jesus says, follow these rules, and he looks, and he says, verse 20, I've obeyed all these commands since I was a kid, and there's something in me that goes, no, you didn't. I think I might have said something. I would have, excuse me, you know, maybe you didn't commit murder. Okay, I'll give you that one, but... Like you never stole anything, like you never took a tent stake out of the person's tent that you got ticked off of and took one of their tent stakes and walked away. Come on, that's a good prank, isn't it? And you never exaggerated, you know, you're with a group of guys and they're talking about how many sheep they have and maybe you just said you have a few more than you act. I'm not buying that you've been perfect since you were a kid. And while I'm trying to expose this guy for being a phony, you're lying, you're not telling the truth. I want you to see how Jesus responds to this guy's statement. Verse 21, Jesus felt genuine love for this man. Let me just stop there and ask you this. Can you see your Savior doing that to you today? Think about this, the supernatural eyes of God piercing into your face, and God, as he's looking at you, he feels this genuine, unbelievable love for you. Think of this, as Jesus' eyes are focused on you, he's having to look around all of your faults, all of your fears, and all of your failures. And as Jesus is looking deep within your soul of who you truly are, he is feeling this unbelievable, genuine love for you. And I'm telling you, that's the way that Jesus looks at you today. It's a powerful moment in Scripture. Verse 21. Jesus, as he says, looks at him that way, says this. You lack only one thing. Go and sell all you have, give it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And after you do that, then come back and come and follow me. Kind of a little bit of a whiplash, isn't it? Here's this guy that comes running in. He's all excited. He asks Jesus this question. Great question. And Jesus responds, and the Bible doesn't give us the tone that Jesus uses in responding, but I imagine if Jesus is looking at him with genuine love, he's probably got a fairly tender tone, and he says these unbelievable, you know, go sell all you have, give the money away, you're going to be rewarded, unbelievable treasure in heaven. And after you do that, then come back and follow me. That's not what the guy wanted to hear. You know what I like about Jesus in this moment? I love the fact that Jesus gave this guy the truth. He didn't give him, hey, here's an easy path to greatness. Jesus knew what it was going to take for this guy and challenged him. He challenged him with, hey, here's the truth. He challenged him to give up that which was most important, most precious to him. And let me pause in this moment, and I want to make this really clear, because sometimes we read this story and this passage, I want to make sure you understand this. This passage does not suggest that material possessions, it doesn't suggest that money is evil. That's not what the Bible ever teaches. The love of money, that's bad. When I put my possessions before I put God, that's bad. But the Bible never teaches that the possessions and our money is bad. What he says in this instance, this guy's barrier to God was materialism. It was his stuff. And if he really wanted what he was looking for, and that was to be great, this guy was going to have to sacrifice that which he loved the most in his life. Verse 22 says that the man's face fell. I love that. Let me come back to that in just a second. At this, the man's face fell. And he went sadly because he had many possessions. This week I went back to the original language. The New Testament is written in Greek, and I went back to the Greek, and I began to look at the words that were used, and that phrase specifically, his face fell. And in my imagination, you know, it kind of runs wild a little bit. I began to think, you know, here's this guy. He comes running in, and he lies about having obeyed everything since he was a kid. And in my mind, the very next thing that happens is his face fell. And I'm thinking to myself, if I'm God, that's exactly what I would do. If he lies to me, his face is falling to the ground. Anybody glad I'm not God? But actually, the Greek translation, the word for face fell, go back to the original language, and here's what it means. The word is describing the sky becoming overcast in an anticipation that there's a storm coming. Do I have anybody from the Midwest where you've been around a season of tornadoes and maybe you haven't seen them, but you've been around where tornadoes are fairly close? Anybody just, a lot of us. You know what I'm talking about. His face looked like the sky becoming overcast in an anticipation of a storm. And I get that. In other words, there is this progressive darkening in this guy's face as he hears the words of Jesus, and then he thinks about all the possessions that he has, and he knew he wasn't going to be able to do what Jesus is talking about doing. And he walks away sadly, and obviously when he walked away, a storm came into his life. That's powerful to me. And I don't know, maybe he thought about all the property that he owned, and the truth was he didn't own the property. The truth is the property owned him. But come on, just like you and me, he wanted greatness, but he just wasn't willing to make the sacrifice to make that greatness happen. And so he walks away. And as he walks away, here's this unbelievable teaching moment. I can just imagine in my mind, this guy's walking out of the room. He leaves the room, and Jesus has this moment with his disciples. And he says this in verse 23, this unbelievable teaching moment. He looks at his disciples who are just astonished right here. It says it in just a moment. And verse 23, Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard is it for the rich people to get into the kingdom of God?" And this amazed the disciples. And this principle totally shocked his closest followers. And so Jesus had to repeat his principle, and he added an illustration. So Jesus said again, "Dear children, it's very hard to get into the kingdom of God." That's the principle. And then he says, verse 25, let me give you an illustration to back that up. Verse 25. "It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to get into the kingdom of God." See, you guys didn't laugh. I just wanted to set you up for that. I wanted to listen, but I want you to know something. I get it. When I tell a brilliant joke up here and nobody laughs, I'm good with that. I really am, because you know what? I'll laugh if nobody else does. And I'm all right with that. You can diss me on my jokes that I tell, but when Jesus is being funny and you don't laugh, man, Jesus is trying to illustrate how difficult it is for a rich guy. And so Jesus says, guys, imagine the largest animal you can think of, and they're thinking about it in their minds, and he's trying to get through the eye or the head, you know, that little place where you put the thread, and that animal is trying to wiggle through the head of a needle. No, still not. And it is a joke. Jesus is trying to get us to understand how crazy this is. And verse 26, the disciples were astounded. They were amazed. Now they're astounded. They said, then who is it that can be saved? See, in Jewish culture, if you're rich, if you had a lot of possessions, the idea is that God had blessed you, that God had smiled on your life, and the reason that you're rich, the reason that you have a lot is because God thinks you're so cool. And the disciples who are very on the other end of that spectrum, they don't have very much, these guys thought, hey, listen, if that guy that is so blessed by God, if he can't get in, we don't have a shot. And in response to that question, who can be saved, verse 27, Jesus looked at them intently and said, humanly speaking, it's impossible. Well, thank you very much. That really helps us. But not with God. Everything is possible with God. You say, Craig, what is he, what's Jesus talking about? Well, no one, and listen, this includes you and me. We're all included. Jesus says none of us can be saved by our wealth. None of us can be saved by our achievements. Nobody can be saved by their talents or how good they are. Craig, you don't understand. I'm a really good person. You're not that good. From a human standpoint, it is impossible for me to be saved on my own terms. But everything is possible with God on his terms. You say, well, okay, Craig, if that's true, then what are God's terms? For that rich guy, God's terms were that God wanted to be number one in that guy's life. Really, the bottom line is simply this, that God wants to be number one in my life, and I want to make sure you know God's desire. He loves you so much, but truly, he wants to be number one in your life. Amen? Come on, verse 28, Peter began to mention all that he and the other disciples had done and left behind. You know, we've given up everything to follow you, Peter said. And if you go to the book of Matthew, remember I told you this story is in three books. It's in Mark where we're at. It's also in Matthew. And Matthew, when he tells this story, same story, he adds another phrase. When Peter says, we've given up everything, Matthew adds that Peter says, and what are we going to get out of it? You know, we've given up everything, Jesus, to follow you. Now, what are we going to get? Peter is thinking, Jesus, it may not mean much to you that we gave up our whole family fishing industry, but it was a big deal to our family. And granted, I admit, I never like to smell the halibut on my hands, but it's beyond that, Jesus. What do I get out of following you? You know, it's fun to see the miracles. It's great to hear the teaching. It's so good to be in your presence. But that's not going to show really well at my 25-year reunion. What am I going to get out of being a follower of yours? And even though it's a self-centered question, and I get that, I happen to believe that God can be, he can answer in the middle of that self-centered question. Anybody with me? And actually, this whole encounter that I've been talking about, as we've been going through this passage of scripture, we're leading to the answer. The whole story, it leads to these last couple of verses, and it's almost like we're on a roller coaster. You know how a roller coaster starts off, and you start clunking up the hill, and it's this anticipation that one in just a few seconds, you're going to go flying down the hill. Anybody just hate that flying down the hill? And you're done with roller coasters for the rest of your life. Anybody with me on that? How many of you go, come on, Craig, let's go on a roller coaster? Anybody like that? Some of you are. Well, I just want you to know, we've kind of been climbing up and we're getting ready for the answer. This is the whole point of the passage. We're ready to go down. You better buckle up your seats. Hang on to your pancreas. Here we go, verse 29. Jesus replied, I assure you, here we go, that everyone who has given up a house, brothers, sisters, mother, father, children, property for my sake, you will receive now in return 100 times over, and beyond that, in the world to come, you'll have eternal life. Yes. In those two verses, Jesus is saying, I just want to let you know that your sacrifices are going to be rewarded 100 times over. And special bonus, just like if you're watching TV and they're going, hey, we'll give you these Jinsu knives. And as a bonus, we'll give you, you know, this is, I can see Jesus doing that. 100 times over. And a special bonus, you'll celebrate forever with God in eternity. That is a pretty good bonus to add on to that. I love Jesus, Matthew. Some of you, you just kind of dismissed what just happened. 100 times over, in your mind, you're thinking, well, that's 100% more. Track with me on this. I'm a pretty good math person. I'm gonna ask those people that are good at math to follow me on this and just see how you think about this. But 100 times more, it isn't just 2 times more. 100 times more. See, we think of 100%. What's that? If I give you $5, 100% more than that is $5 more. But 100 times more, that's what Jesus said. If I give you $5 and I get you 100 times more, then you're going to, come on, math people, help me out with this. I give you $5, 100 times more than $5 is, yes, look at all these math people. We have brilliant people at OVCN. Let me just state the obvious. This is a good investment. And what Jesus is saying here is you're going to be rewarded both now and in eternity. The one thing I want you to get, and please write this down in your notes somewhere. Write this statement down. One thing that I want you to walk away from is sacrifice is the investment to greatness. Sacrifice is the investment to greatness. For those of you who want, you want to know what's on the test for next week, this is it right here. Bring this statement back. I want you to remember, sacrifice is the investment for greatness. You've written it down. Hopefully you've written it down. If you're not, you're not going to remember it, and you'll fail the test next week. So let's say this together. Throw it up there. Come on, let's say this. Sacrifice is the investment to greatness. Jesus says, if you want sacrifice, if you sacrifice one relationship, Jesus says that keeps you from us having a close relationship. Then Jesus says, then you're going to see 100 relationships where love will come to the surface. Jesus says things like this, if you sacrifice one habit that is destroying your life and you sacrifice that habit, that bad habit for my sake, then I'm going to give you 100 new habits that will enrich your life. Come on, we think about money. Stop thinking about money on this right now. This is an amazing principle. You sacrifice your riches for my sake, Jesus says, and you will experience a depth of richness in your life that you couldn't possibly have dreamed of before. Do you realize how amazing this is that Jesus is talking about? As a pastor, I can't promise you when you're going to get that 100 times more. I can't. I'd be lying if I told you when it was going to happen. In fact, that's not even my role, and it's not your role. Your role is to sacrifice. See, your role is to say, God, my life is completely yours. God's part is to do the 100 times more. Listen, I promise you, God's bank can handle this. And Jesus ends this teachable moment by referring to eternal life, verse 31. And Jesus says, but many who seem to be important now will be the least important then. And those who are considered least here will be the greatest then. Greatness is not an exclusive club. A lot of people have the appearance of greatness today, but they haven't sacrificed and they don't have a relationship with God. But you just wait till eternity rolls around and they're going to be the least. And basically what Jesus is saying is that God honors our sacrifice, both now, today, here on, he will reward us on this playground called earth, and bonus, he'll reward us for all eternity. So let me make this personal to you. Let's imagine that you could walk up to Jesus right now. You could walk up to Jesus and you would say, Jesus, I want the great life that you have planned for me. What do I need to sacrifice? What do I need in my life? What do I have to give up in order to have that great life? What do you think Jesus would say to you? You know, I think for probably about half of the people that are here today, you already know the answer to that. It's that thing that you're struggling with in your life. It's that thing that comes up to your mind so often, and you struggle back and forth with God. It quickly comes to your mind, and we know how difficult it is to give that up because we want to hold on to that so much, and yet God is saying, hey, would you let that go? Because I want you to have greatness in your life. We want greatness, but we're just not sure if we're willing to sacrifice. And I think there's a whole other group of people, and you're sitting here today and you're going, Craig, I'd really love to know what it is in my life that I love most dearly. And so I thought, you know what, I'm going to have an illustration. I went out to my garage last night and I started hunting around for a perfect box. I didn't even know what kind of box I was looking for. And finally I found this box. It's ironic that for me, it is a box that used to, just last night, it was filled with racquetballs. And I just got to tell you, in my life, one of the things that I love most dearly is playing racquetball. Anybody with me? It's Chris. Yeah, I love it. Some of the guys I play racquetball that are here, you know I love the racquetball, right? But I want you to think of this box and what it represents for you, because I got to tell you, what it represents for you is going to be different than what it represents for me. Amen? So really the question is, in your life, what's in the box? What is it that you love so much that you go, I really want to get on that path to greatness that God has for me, but I don't want to give this up, and it's difficult for me to let this go, to grab on. And if you're going, well, I don't know what that is, let me give you some things that might trigger something in your mind. If you're a teenager here, you may need to sacrifice the comfort of some of your friendships that you know are not good for you. If you're in the marketplace and at your job, you're working so much to build your reputation and you're pouring all of your life into that job, and you may need to sacrifice and let go of the illusion of success in order to discover the significance that God wants to bring into your life. If you're addicted to something, you may need to sacrifice your pride in order to beg a friend to help you and walk with you through that path of being released from the prison that you're trapped in. If you're materialistic and that's the thing that's in the box, then you know your life is about stuff and more cars, newer house, and all that stuff. And then you might need to make the sacrifice of letting some of that stuff go in order to loosen the grip of your possessions so that you can grab hold of a God that loves you and have a plan for greatness in your life. I don't know what it is for you, but I can tell you what the promises of God are. The promises of God are this, that when you and I decide that we're going to sacrifice, that we're going to be blessed by that sacrifice. That sacrifice then becomes an investment to getting on the plan, the path for greatness. Remember at the first of the message, I talked a little bit about people here who are kind of checking this out and kicking the tires, and you're not really sure if you're ready to make a decision for Jesus Christ or not. Maybe you're thinking to yourself, you know, Craig, when you talk about sacrifice, I just want to push back, and I want to say that's not what I want. Why would I need a God? Why would I need somebody else telling me what to do? I want to control my own life. And if that's you today and you're sitting here and that's your statement, listen, I've been there. I know that. But then I realized at that point in my life where I said, hey, I want to control what I want to do, all of a sudden it hit me how much God loves me and cares for me. And God wanted me to have a better life than I ever possibly dreamed of. And it was at that point that I said, you know what? I'm willing to sacrifice my pride, because what I want more than what's in that box is I want a relationship with a God that loves me. Amen. Listen, I want that for you. And it was at that point in my life where I took the steering wheel of my life and I just said, God, from this point on, you take control. I'm following you. Not that I'm going to be perfect, but God, from this point on, I just want to follow you. And God came into my life and he blessed me way more than I ever thought could even be possible. And I stand up here today, you say, Craig, why are you so crying baby all the time? And I'll just tell you this. Come on, I'm serious about this. It's because what I'm speaking about today, I want this for you. I want you to experience the joy of having a relationship with a God that loves you. I want you to have a confidence that God is in control. And when the rest of the world is full of fear and what are we going to do? You know that a God who loves you is in control and he's going to help you. I want you to have that feeling of love of being a part of a community of believers. I want you to have the freedom from guilt in your life and resentment, and I want you to have forgiveness of sins. I want that for you. But I also want you to know this, that there was that time where I had to put my pride aside and I had to say, God, I want you more than anything else. And yet, I got to tell you, for me, it has become a daily prayer in my life. God, I want you more than anything else. And wherever you take me today, the best that not that I'm going to be perfect, but the best I know how, I want to say yes to you. And every morning when I wake up, I just say, God, whatever's in that box, whatever you have for me, and say, hey, would you give that up? So, yes. And here's my whole point today. I want to make sure you catch this. Sacrifice is the investment for greatness. If you want that great life that God has planned for your soul, you don't have to walk out of here today sad and discouraged. Listen, you can make the choice today. It's your choice, right? You can say yes to what God wants to do in your life. Amen? Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? Heavenly Father, Thank you for the simple fact that when you look into our lives, you look past all of our faults, all of our failures and our fears. And when you look at each one of us today, right now, you look at us with that genuine, crazy love for us. And that causes us to say yes to you. We give up whatever is in the way, whatever's in the box, so that we can have that great life that you have planned for each one of us. So Heavenly Father, as we close this service, I pray that you would give us wisdom to know what to do with what we've heard. It's gonna be different for different people. But not only wisdom, Lord, I pray you'll give us the courage to act on what we know we need to do. Help us to say yes to you. Each morning this week, Lord, whatever you have for me today, yes. Above everything else, it's you, Lord. Yes. In Jesus' name, we pray these things, and all God's people said, amen. God bless you. Have a great week. We'll see you next week.